Remote Interpretation, Medio IGC 303, Unit 2. I'm Dr. Isabel Souza, your presenter for this unit as well. So it's going to be fun to talk about remote interpreting. Let's start with the differences from on-site interpretation. First of all, the pre-session or introduction is more difficult, right? I mentioned how oftentimes I would get on the line and provider would start saying, tell her this or that. So in remote interpreting in general, a certain assertiveness is needed. And I'm not saying to be rude or overstep the provider. We have to be incredibly polite with providers. You have to speak up as a professional and just say, excuse me, the interpreter would like to introduce herself and go ahead and do the introduction. You will have to be quicker, and as you learn the introduction, it will always go quicker and quicker because you'll know how to phrase it just right. It becomes like your elevator pitch. Find out what technology is being used. Are the parties on a speakerphone? Is it a dual phone, a three-way, a cell phone? Maybe there's a lot of background noise. So take care of those noise issues that technology may bring. Sometimes it's a speakerphone without, it doesn't have like a duplex function. And what happens is if somebody speaks over someone else, you get a blank. So should that happen and somebody be speaking and then you hear it, don't just gloss it over, but explain, it seems that this phone has this issue. I really need you to allow the individual to finish speaking and then start. And you would say this in both languages. But technology is wonderful so long as you know how to use it and you, adapt accordingly. You don't have the visual cues, especially if you're on the phone, but you have voice cues. And we can't forget that, a lot of the communication is, nonverbal, but a lot of it is just the tone, the way the person's speaking. You can get a lot of emotion out of the voice of the patient. And you can even get some of the state of mind, fear, many things can come out in the voice. So just pay attention. And, with remote interpreting and on the phone, definitely have to have, no distractions. So talking on a cell phone on the street just simply will not work and is not professional. You need to be prepared to take the call on a first ring. So remote interpreters have to be on standby and ready to go. So when you press that button that you're available, you need to be available. Any hesitation can be seen as a lack of preparation. And that was the first thing I ever stated. You need to have a professional background if you're in video interpreting and have a professional attire, as I've mentioned before. Use of specialized headphone or microphone may be required and makes a huge difference. If you have the noise canceling headsets, you really will be able to interpret better. Your quality of interpretation will increase and your microphone also will have a difference in how the parties will hear you and understand you. Use of specialized software may be required. Each remote interpreting company has a different software. Sometimes they require that you're connected directly to the router instead of through Wi-Fi. They all employers want a steady, stable equipment that will work and that your voice is not going to go, in between an interpretation. Let's move on to the next slide and we can see now, another point, we've talked about note-taking a little bit, but I cannot impart enough the importance of note-taking as a way to help your work. It's easier when you're doing remote interpreting because you're not sitting without a desk. Hopefully you have a nice place to write on. And when you're doing remote interpreting, you know, you can't really signal with a hand. You really need to use your voice because hopefully people are not looking at you. So signaling with the hand doesn't often work anyway. You need to know when to interject and you need to use your voice and have a voice that has a certain amount of projection. If you talk very softly, it becomes incredibly difficult. So work on your voice, especially for remote interpreting. Simultaneous interpreting can be very difficult over the phone. It can get people very confused. It's just one of the barriers. There are now some new platforms called RSI, Remote Simultaneous Interpreting Platforms. I suspect remote simultaneous will come into medical interpreting within the next decade for sure. But at the moment, it's really mostly on the consecutive, especially if it's remotely. Each setting and facility may have different procedures. So some facilities use video mostly, others rely on phone, others have moving polycoms still. So that's why we have a variety of different equipment being used. Check for understanding frequently, verify dosages when you're doing note-taking, repeat frequently. There's nothing wrong with when you're receiving that information, that you actually repeat it, just as we do when we're giving out a credit card number or anything like that. Let's move on to the next. But do, hopefully you're already note-taking and have been doing so even in your practice sessions. So we're going to talk here about the benefits of remote interpreting. It helps reduce response time, and that's probably, I would say, the biggest reason why it has become so popular. Providers are in such a time crunch, and sometimes we can criticize them for being rushed, for not paying enough attention. Well, they're under incredible amounts of stress, and even waiting 5 minutes for an interpreter to walk from one building to the other may really kill a lot of time that the provider just doesn't have. So the ability to, you know, pick up a phone or dial a video interpreter when the patient and the provider are ready to see each other is really a huge advantage. Or sometimes patients, you know, see different providers. They'll see the nurse for 5 minutes and then there may be a 5 minute break before the provider comes in. So being able to have these small, interactions stop and then start again when the interaction is going to start again. Use of the computer. That's a wonderful benefit. Every office now has a computer. Use of online resources. That can be very useful for us when doing telephone or remote interpreting, having, you know, our online dictionaries and glossaries right at the tip of our fingers. Some call centers actually have the interpreters logged into the patient record. So even when the patient is misspelling their address or mispronouncing it, you have that information right on the screen in front of you if you happen to work in an environment with that ability. And it's just wonderful because they might be describing, oh, I saw Dr. Ramirez, and you look in the and you see that it was actually Dr. Ramiro, not Ramirez. So it can be very helpful and you can feel like you have the context of the situation. And a lot of times you can have scripts available to you as well. So having technology can be very useful. So working as a remote interpreter, not to count with the advantages of working from anywhere, being able to move and retain your job, that can be fantastic. Another benefit I'll mention here is if you work for a language that we may call a minority language or language of lesser diffusion, or maybe it's a language of majority in one city, but you move to a city and hardly anyone speaks that, remote interpreting allows you to work for populations outside of your locality. So it's very useful for a very rarely requested language that perhaps is spread out throughout the country. So let's move on to the next slide. And we're going to talk about when to use on-site versus remote interpreting. So remember we had talked about telling providers to allow these circumstances to dictate. And here's some of those circumstances. So when is on-site interpreting typically best? Certainly for mental health interpreting, simply because these are very long encounters and being present, sometimes continuing care with the same patient may be required. So on-site is oftentimes used for mental health interpreting. It's best in a crisis or a highly sensitive interpreting session. Again, just because, you know, body language can be better read, and sometimes certain news, you know, is better given in person than remotely. It's best for trauma patients, best for the elderly and children sometimes, because they might have a hard time understanding what's coming out of the phone, or maybe their voice is frail. And it's also best for patient education or demonstrations. It becomes difficult when, you know, even a physical therapy session, when there's a lot of showing body parts and the interpreter has to either be able to see it or the provider is going to have to refer to everything they're looking at and they're pointing to. And I'll mention, on-site interpreting sometimes is the choice for sign language interpreters. They have a stronger resistance to remote interpreting. And in the U.S., for example, deaf and hard of hearing actually have the choice of which to use. Whereas in spoken language interpreting, it's more left up to the provider. But I'll say that the interpreter can also have a say if a particular method is just not working. Or modality, we like to say modality for these differences. Now, remote interpreting is best when a qualified interpreter is needed in a short time frame. So the, you know, time frame can be a big issue, and remote interpreting is almost immediate. Usually, you know, within less than a minute, you'll have the interpreter available, which can't be said for a face-to-face interpreter. It's also best for when you want to use resources effectively. And saying this because you may have a session of an hour where the patient sees the triage nurse for 5 minutes, then goes to the waiting room, then sees an intern or a resident for 15 minutes, and then goes back to the waiting area. And then finally, maybe half an hour goes by before that patient is seen by a provider. So in a face-to-face situation, that interpreter would just be sitting there waiting until each party needs them, unless they're working in a staff setting where they might leave and come back. So the resources can be used more effectively when, you know, you're really only having the interpreter available when you need the interpreter available. So in that situation, you would have three different sessions, probably with three different interpreters. It's also best for when you have a limited access to a qualified interpreter. So unless you have staff interpreters in your hospital or your clinic, you're going to have to rely on remote interpreting. Unless the interpretation is scheduled, some clinics may only be able to do on-site when it's scheduled. When it's a walk-in, they just aren't prepared, and there's no time to engage in securing the services of an on-site interpreter. And remote is also very good for situations where there may be a patient may be contagious. So tuberculosis patients, and now we have COVID-19 and other situations. Definitely a lot of interpreters are now working remotely unless they absolutely have to be with the patient. So remote telemedicine is actually being used more for that situation as well. So we're not the only ones working remotely. Many providers are now working remotely. So let's move on to the next slide. And here are some good online resources for you. We want you to take a look at each of these before you go into the next unit. So wordreference.com is a wonderful, vocabulary reference website. Medline Plus is a great website as well for any disease that you want to know more about or treatment. It really has everything. Kaiser's trilingual glossaries are great, and WebMD. And now on the internet, frankly, it's just an amazing resource that we all have. So you can look up anything in your target languages and in English, and you will find it. And sometimes if I'm not sure if a particular medical phrase is used as much in one language or another, I'll actually Google it and see what comes up. So you can even Google some phrases that you want to see how popular they are in the language. So there's a lot you can do with Google, and there are a lot of multilingual glossaries available in many websites. So do check these resources, and this is the end of this session. So thank you very much for listening.